Hey everyone, welcome back to Neurobiology at Providence College. I'm Joe DeGiorgis. Today's lecture is part three of the Buck and Axel paper titled A Novel Multigene Family May Encode Odorant Receptors, Molecular Basis for Odor Recognition. It was published in Cell in 1991. Buck and Axel knew from previous experiments that there was a tissue that was in the base of the nose. And it contained three cell types. It contained olfactory sensory neurons that have an axon that goes back to the brain, and of course a nucleus. And there are some support cells also in the tissue, and small basal cells at the base of the tissue. Like this. And they knew that this tissue was involved in sensing odor because if you remove this, these cilia here at the top of the olfactory sensory neurons, that the organism could no longer smell. They also suspected that whatever the receptor was, that it would lie in the membrane of these cilia, and that it was likely part of a large group of receptors because we detect a wide variety of odors, and that they were likely to be associated with G proteins because adding odor to isolated cilia activated adenylate cyclase and caused cyclic AMP production. And it was known at that time that the types of receptors that are associated with G proteins are called 7 transmembrane domain G protein coupled receptors. So they have 7 regions that span the membrane. So the protein starts out here and then it goes through the membrane. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 7, like this. And these types of receptors are those that associate with the alpha, the beta, and the gamma subunits of GTP-associated proteins, G proteins. And when the ligand comes in, the odorant in this particular case, and it binds to the receptor, we said that the alpha subunit, which is associated with GDP at this point, gets released, that it replaces the GDP with GTP, so we have the alpha subunit with GTP, and that this beta subunit then associates with adenylate cyclase. And adenylate cyclase then converts an ATP molecule into cyclic AMP, which then binds to a cyclic AMP-gated ion channel and allows ions to flow into the cell to depolarize the neuron and cause an action potential, which carries an electrical signal to the brain for that odor. And somehow that confers that smell to the brain. Okay, so then they made 3 assumptions. And we said that the 3 assumptions were that the receptors are associated with G proteins. Because the odorant causes cyclic AMP production, and that part was known. So it's likely that these receptors are associated with these G proteins here. That there was a large family, a multi-gene family, because there are lots of odors that we can detect, and it makes sense that each odor would bind to a specific receptor, like a lock and key type of mechanism. And we described how a large family of genes can come about through issues of homologous recombination over evolutionary time. And finally, the third assumption was that these genes would be expressed in the nose. Because we smell with our nose. And of course, what they mean by expressed in the nose or gene expression is that the genes are turned on and they're making messenger RNA, and those messenger RNAs are being read by the ribosomes and translated into proteins, into amino acid sequences. And even though all cells of the body contain a complete set of genomic DNA, that is the entire blueprint for the organism, not all of the genes are turned on. So that's what makes the tissues of our bodies unique. I mean, it makes some subset of genes are turned on that create brain, and another subset create muscle and skin and so on. And gene expression can change on a daily basis, or indeed it does change on a daily basis. It also can change over the course of our life and so on. So what they mean is that the genes are expressed, this particular family of genes are likely to be expressed in the nose because that's where we smell or detect odor. So in the paper, what they would like to do is try to identify receptors that are associated with G proteins. And we've already said that those receptors that associate with G proteins are these seven transmembrane domain receptor molecules. So they are going to try to search to see if this type of receptor exists in this tissue type, whether it's a multi-gene family, and whether this multi-gene family is ultimately expressed in the nose. I mean, they're going to try to prove these three things. So to start to look for proteins, receptor molecules that associate with G proteins, they want to first try to identify RNAs that express these types of receptors, seven transmembrane domain receptors, G protein associated receptors. Okay, so how do they go about doing that? Well, first, they have to dissect out this piece of tissue from the nose, and they did that from rats. They're using rats in this particular study. So once they have their piece of tissue, they biochemically purify RNAs, messenger RNAs, from the tissue. And that is pretty simple to do. You can get the RNAs to bind to a matrix and purify the messenger RNA. But we've said if you want to use PCR, which is what they're going to try to do to find genes that are being expressed that encode the seven transmembrane domain receptors, they have to take all of the RNA molecules and convert them into double-stranded DNA, what they refer to as copy or cDNA. And what we said is to do that, you take all of the different RNA molecules, and they, if they're messenger RNA, they all have a poly A tail. So you can bind a string of T's that you purchase in a test tube. And you use an enzyme, a protein isolated from bacteria called reverse transcriptase, which reads this top strand and makes a complementary strand here. So we said, you know, if there's a C here, of course that would provide, would add a G down here, and if it's G up here, it would put a C down here, and an A would give you a T, because in this particular case even though this is an RNA molecule, which consists of A, U, G, and C, we're adding A, T, C, and G, though, as the nucleotides in this reaction, and so there are no U's available, and the reverse transcriptase reads along, and it adds a T instead of the U, and it makes this complementary strand like this, which is now a DNA strand, and it's the complement to the top strand. And then we dissolve the top strand away with an RNase, which chews up RNA, and then we add DNA polymerase, and it looks at this bottom strand, and it creates now a second strand on top, or a new strand on top, that's complementary to the bottom, and it contains T's. So you've converted an RNA molecule with this into double-stranded DNA, and the top strand is identical to the RNA, except that now the U's have all been replaced by T's. So you do that for every single one of the RNAs. I mean, you just do it in a mixture. It happens all at once. And now you can use PCR to try to amplify segments of the RNA, of those RNAs that might encode the seven transmembrane domain receptors. But how do you make the PCR primers? You have to look at other what they did is they found other sequences for known seven transmembrane domain receptors. You look it up in a database, which we'll do as part of a laboratory exercise, but you might have a sequence, and when they give you the sequence, they're just giving you this of an RNA molecule. They're just giving you this top strand, so they ignore the bottom strand because they know that if you know the top strand, you can figure out what the bottom strand is, because if it's an A up here, it's a T down here. If it's a G up here, it's a C down here, and so on. So you can find a sequence of these top strands, messenger RNAs, sequences from known seven transmembrane domain proteins, and you can line them up. So there might be some already known in rat. So this is, let's say, rat sequence one for one type of receptor, one species of receptor, species meaning not organismal species, but they use the term species to denote a specific RNA sequence. And then we have a second one, which makes a different receptor. I mean, still both seven transmembrane domain receptors, but two different ones. And you can line them up using a computer program, and you can look for regions that are identical. That is, this one might have an A here, and the bottom one, the second RNA molecule, also has an A. These are from two different genes, but they're related, they're a family, they were derived from problems of homologous recombination, and there might be a T here, and a T down here, and then a G here, and a G down here. And it might be identical. These two different RNA molecules might be identical for a stretch like this. This part's identical. And then you might find some differences, like this one's an A up here, and this one's a C down here. And so there might be differences, and that's what makes them a different receptor, are those differences. And then you might find another conserved region here, highly conserved, 100% identical, or maybe it's a little less, maybe it's 99% or 98%, but still very highly similar. And then you might have a region that's variable again. But if you can find two areas that are conserved throughout evolution, first of all, it means that those areas are important, because if it gets mutated, it causes the organism to die or not be as successful in terms of survival and reproduction. And now if you know this stretch right here of this, you know a little region here like this is known to be highly conserved. Now you can make a PCR primer that will bind to this, this upstream primer would bind to this part of this molecule, and then the second primer here would bind to this part of the molecule, right? And now if you do PCR, you will generate a piece that's this size. And if there are other RNA molecules, so this is a cDNA that's been created from one RNA molecule, and if there are other RNA molecules that have been converted into cDNA that encode 7 transmembrane domain proteins, then it's likely that this area is conserved in those RNAs. So when you do the PCR reaction, the PCR primers might bind to all of the different RNAs, or cDNAs if you want to think of it that way, that encode 7 transmembrane domain receptors. And you will amplify the area from here to here in all of those different RNA molecules. So you have a bunch of RNAs. I mean, I described this a little bit before. So this is RNA 1 that encodes a 7 transmembrane domain receptor, RNA 2, RNA 3, like this. And there may be more, but if those primers can bind to each of these different RNAs, well, of course, they've been converted into cDNA, it would amplify this stretch in this RNA, this stretch in this RNA, this stretch in this RNA, or cDNA, if you want to say it that way, because that's what's used in the PCR reaction. But now when you run it out in a gel, all three of these PCR products that are all in one tube, and you run it on the gel, and you would get a big band PCR product, which, of course, are millions of copies of a segment of DNA, in this case. And this could be a mixture, though, because the size is the same. This band could represent a mixture of different PCR products from different cDNAs that were derived from different RNA molecules. So I hope that makes sense. So their help was to design a wide variety of different PCR primers that they used in different combinations, and they hoped that some pairs of primers would amplify multiple cDNAs, that is multiple RNA sequences from this particular tissue type from the nose. In figure 1, they show two gels in part A, figure 1A, and these are different primer combinations. I mean, each lane is a different set of primers. The first lane, they have an M up here, and that's for a molecular weight marker. So those are pieces of DNA of known size so that you can figure out the size of your PCR product. So these are just bands, and we can look it up and it tells you in the paper, but this might be, you know, 1,000 base pairs, and this is 500 base pairs, and this is 400 base pairs, and so on. So they're bands of known sizes of DNA so that you can try to understand the size of your PCR product. Then they have different PCR reactions, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. And those are different primer sets, all designed to try to amplify cDNAs of RNAs of 7 transmembrane domain receptor molecules. So they have in the first gel 1 through 11. They have another molecular weight marker in the middle and another one at the end, just so you can easily reference that. And then in the second gel, they have more reactions. They have 3 lanes again of the molecular weight marker, and then they have 12, 13, 14, and so on, all the way up to 22 different PCR reactions. different primer combinations, all trying to amplify those seven transmembrane domain receptors, that is the RNAs or the cDNAs that give rise to those proteins. And you can see that they get a PCR product that's pretty bright. If you look in lane one, you have a nice bright band, and you can see that band in two, and you can see it. Three has a bunch of wacky bands down here, which probably are artifacts, but then four and five and so on. So there's this band right in here that is being amplified, and that probably means that those primers are all working and they're all amplifying those sequences, the cDNAs and the RNAs of the seven transmembrane domain receptors. And you see something like that in the second gel 2, you see in 12, there's a big bright band, and in 13, there's a bright band. 14 looks a little funny because there's a couple of bands. And then in 15, well, there's no band, except they all have this low band down here, which is an artifact. Those are called primer dimers, which I don't want to get into, but it's very common to see that band. So 15 doesn't have a band in it, but then others do. So it looks like many of the primer sets are working, and this is the PCR product that they were hoping to see. And indeed, they have a PCR product that looks promising, that they've amplified one or more cDNAs of RNAs of the seven transmembrane domain proteins or genes. Okay, so I'm going to just redraw this so it's a little bit neater. So we have two gels. I'm just going to draw the first gel. And we have a molecular weight marker, and a molecular weight marker. And then we have 1, 2, 3, and so on. And the molecular weight markers have known sizes of DNA, so we can figure out the size of our PCR product, like this. And then you can see a band in many of the lanes, like this. And there are some other faint bands that differ in size, which are most likely artifacts, but they're ignoring those bands. And it turns out that in lane 13, well, I guess I should draw the second gel since lane 13 is on the second gel. We have up to 11 here, we said, and then there's 12 and 13 and so on. And there's another molecular weight marker like this. Okay, that's our gel. And what they say is that they get this band that they suspect is what they're looking for. That is, it is a sequence, a PCR product of cDNAs of RNAs that encode seven transmembrane domain proteins. They then decide, so they have a test tube for each, and the PCR product, the test tube that they used for the reaction. And they have sample 1, sample 2, sample 3, and so on. And they use some of it. They use some of the PCR reaction, of course, to run their gel. But it's not all used up, so they still have all of their different samples. And they add a restriction enzyme. Now, restriction enzymes cut DNA at very specific locations. And one that they use in this study is called HAE3. And this enzyme cuts at a very specific location at GGCC, and it cuts here like this. So if you add this restriction enzyme to these PCR products, it looks for this sequence in any of the PCR products, and if it finds a GGCC, it cuts the DNA strand at that particular point. So if we have a cDNA molecule, let's say, and we reverse transcribed it and created cDNA from the RNA molecule, and then we PCR amplified a region, so we use PCR primers and one bound here in one bound here, and we did the reaction. Of course, we would create a PCR product that's this big in length, and this length in this particular PCR product is this band here. So we're saying that this is derived from an RNA molecule of the seven transmembrane domain receptors, one of them. And now if you add the restriction enzyme, it looks for this site, and let's say that it cuts it here. So if we look at the molecular weight markers and we try to figure out what size this band is, let's say it's 700 base pairs long, for the sake of conversation, okay? We could look at the details and figure out exactly what that size is. But now if we have a piece here, this amplified stretch from here to here is 700 base pairs in size. So this full-length PCR product is 700 base pairs in size. But now we've cut it into two fragments. And let's say that this is now, this part here is 500 base pairs in size. Then this would have to be 200 base pairs in size. And if we ran a gel of this, and we had our, this is figure B, this is figure A, we would have our molecular weight marker again here. And if we cut this fragment here, this PCR product here, sample one, and we cut it and now we run it on the gel, we would get two bands from this reaction. And one we would be 500 base pairs long, and the other one would be 200 base pairs long, because we've cut this thing in two in this particular example. So they do this. They add the restriction enzyme to all of the different reactions, 22 different reactions. And what they want to do is figure out whether there's any lane where the products, this product in this case, 200 and 500, are there any examples where the two fragments add up to more than 700 base pairs? Because if that's the case, it suggests that you didn't just amplify one cDNA of a transmembrane, seven transmembrane receptor, that you amplified more than one cDNA. So if this sample contains two different receptors, then you would have two different cDNA molecules, right? You would have one for receptor one, and one for receptor two, like this. And we would have, if you amplified two, again, this primer would have bound here, and this one would have bound here in the PCR reaction, and we would have created two different stretches, both of which are 700 base pairs long, and they run together in the gel. I mean, there's millions of copies of DNAs in this PCR product, and it could be a mixture of more than one if they're the same size. So now we have another cDNA that generates this fragment like this, but its sequence is slightly different because it's a different receptor molecule. And if you add the restriction enzyme to this sample, maybe you get a cut here where this fragment is 400 base pairs long and this fragment is 300 base pairs long. So if you have a sample where you have multiple bands, you have one that's 500 base pairs long here, 500, and you have one that's 200 because you cut this fragment in two here, and there was a second amplification and you ended up getting a 400 base pair fragment and a 300 base pair fragment, now there must be more than one PCR product in the reaction because these add up to more than 700. In fact, they add up to 1400 because, well, there's 500, 400, 300, and 200 is 1400. I mean, it's twice. There are two copies that were 700 base pairs long. So now you have these products that add up to more than 700. So they say in the paper that sample 13, when they digested it with the restriction enzyme, had a whole bunch of different bands. And indeed, if you look at lane 13 in figure B, so 13 here, you see a whole bunch of different fragments that were generated by the PCR primers used in reaction 13. Okay, phew. I know it took a long time to get here, but just to summarize, they dissected a piece of tissue that they knew contained olfactory sensory neurons that are responsible for odor detection. They purified messenger RNA from that tissue, total messenger RNA. They converted the RNAs to double-stranded DNA, that is copy DNA, and they used PCR primers specific for amplifying genes that encode 7 transmembrane domain receptors, and they used those PCR primers in PCR reactions with the cDNA to try to amplify sequences that would encode those proteins. They obtained a wide variety of PCR products, and they decided to digest the products to determine whether one of the PCR products contained more than one amplified segment of cDNA or RNAs that encode those particular proteins. They find in sample 13 that when they digest it, the fragments that they obtain equal a higher number than 700 base pairs, which is the size of the original PCR product. And that gave them the idea that sample 13 contains multiple amplified sequences of the 7 transmembrane domain family of genes. So they take sample 13, a tube like this, and they sequence the individual molecules from the sample. That is, they obtain the order of the A, T, C's, and G's for that amplified sequence. And they end up getting 5 unique sequences that are all different from one another, but still highly similar to one another in other messenger RNAs that had been previously sequenced by other scientists that encode 7 transmembrane domain proteins. It turns out they used a second technique called a cDNA library screen, which I'm not going to get into, but in the process they found 5 more messenger RNAs that encode unique 7 transmembrane domain receptors. If you know the RNA sequence, then you can deduce the amino acid sequence by translating the triplets, the codons, like AUG, for instance, is a messenger RNA triplet that encodes methionine. They did that for all 10 messenger RNA molecules, and then they analyzed the protein sequences. And they indeed determined that in all cases, these proteins contain 7 transmembrane domains. Those are stretches of amino acids of about 20 amino acids long that are all hydrophobic. And so that stretch spans the cell membrane and it hides from the aqueous environment that are found both in the outside and the inside of the cell. Okay, there's only one more figure that I'd like to go over in this publication, and that's figure number 8. Figure 8 is a northern blot, which is a way of determining whether a gene is expressed, that is to say, whether an RNA molecule is produced in a given sample type, they start with a gel, just like a DNA gel. It's made of agarose, but they're going to run RNA in the gel rather than DNA. And they have a variety of different samples. They have the olfactory tissue, they have brain tissue, they have heart, they have kidney, liver, ovary, retina, and spleen. And for each of these samples, they have to dissect out the tissue, and then they have to purify messenger RNA from each tissue type. And then they load it into the gel. You know that there are wells up here, and you pipette in the RNA for each of the samples. And then you apply electricity to this, and the different RNAs travel down through the matrix, and the smaller pieces travel faster than the bigger pieces, but all of the different RNAs of the sample are spread out throughout the agarose gel based on their molecular weight. So if we were just to stain this for the presence of the RNA, you'd just see a zillion bands because there are all these different RNA molecules in each lane. But if we don't stain, then you can't see the RNA. It just looks clear. You have a clear gel. And what they do is they place a piece of paper. I mean, it's fancy paper, but it's a membrane. But they place that underneath the gel, and then they run the electricity instead of down in this direction, they run it through the gel from the top to the bottom, and that chases the RNA bands out of the gel onto the piece of paper. So now you have a piece of paper, and you can throw out the agar part of it here, and everything is invisible, but just realize that if we were to stain it, just to stain nucleic acids, then you would see this banding pattern now on the piece of paper or on the membrane. But again, we still have the olfactory tissue, brain, heart, kidney, liver, ovary, retina, and spleen. Okay, now they need a way to probe this membrane with the RNAs on it for the presence of RNA molecules that they discovered in the olfactory tissue. So they take RNA from olfactory tissue, mRNA from olfactory tissue. They convert it into cDNA, just like they had done before. And then they use primers that will amplify the RNA sequences that they discovered in the nose by the original PCR experiment or through the library screen. But this time when they do the PCR reaction, they do the PCR in the presence of radioactive nucleotides. So now the nucleotides that they're adding to synthesize PCR products are hot. Okay? Now, remember, let's just review this one more time. So if they discovered a sequence, an RNA sequence, that encodes a 7 transmembrane domain receptor, then they have to convert this into double-stranded DNA, copy DNA, and they would use primers to amplify a portion of this cDNA. So they make very specific primers that will amplify this particular cDNA, and we said that to make the primers, one is identical to this sequence, and that would bind to this part of the molecule, this lower strand. And if you make another PCR primer here, which will bind to the top strand, which is identical to this region, when you do the PCR reaction, you will amplify this region of the cDNA molecule, or RNA molecule, if you want to think of it that way. Because this is identical to the original RNA molecule, except that the U's have been replaced by T's. So now we have a piece that's this long, and it's derived from a messenger RNA expressed in the olfactory tissue of the rat. And of course, these two strings are held together by hydrogen bonds between the bases in this direction, like this. And this PCR product now is radioactive. I mean, both strands are radioactive. And if you heat this PCR product up, then these two bands come apart. So you have the top band like this, and then the bottom band like this, both radioactive. But this band now, this strand rather, is complementary to this strand, which is, of course, the same as this strand. So it's complementary, this is complementary to the RNA molecule. So now if the RNA molecule is present on our membrane, this single-stranded radioactive probe will bind to the complementary RNA. And so they add this in solution to this membrane that has all of the different RNAs from each sample type, and it only binds to RNAs that are complementary to this probe. After they add the probe, which again is radioactive, they place a piece of film in the dark over this membrane, and they leave it there for 24 hours or something along those lines. And then they remove this piece of film and they develop it. And wherever the radioactivity was exposes the film, and that turns dark. And what they find is that in the olfactory tissue, the complementary strand shows that those RNAs are present in this tissue type. And in all the other lanes in figure 8, there is no reaction. That is, this probe doesn't bind to any RNAs in these other tissue types. In this experiment, they show that the genes that they discovered through their PCR experiment are expressed only in the tissue of the nose and not in other tissue types. So they prove their three assumptions. One, are there G protein associated receptors? Are there a multi-gene family? Are they expressed in the nose? Yes, there are 7 transmembrane domain G protein coupled receptors in the nose. They discovered 10. Is it a multi-gene family? Yes, they discovered at least 10, and there are probably more, and those 10 are only expressed in the nose. Okay, everyone, that's it for today. I hope you enjoyed reading the paper. As I mentioned, Buck and Axel won the Nobel Prize for elucidating how we detect odor.